So how much does it cost for an individual to get skilled?
If you're talking about
approximately, a
retail person, you know, 30 days of training, get assessments, anywhere between 5,000 to 7,500, he could get a level 2 or level 3 certificate. If you talk about a welder, it could be 50 to 60,000, right? If you talk about automobile engineer, automobile mechanic, then it becomes, because you know, the cost of welding equipment and all has to also be factored in. So what we actually did with McKinsey earlier on, and why NSDC is trying to promote scale, that if you do, you know, 1,000 to 3,000 people a year, it costs you about 15 to 20,000 to 30,000 rupees to train a person. But if you do 10,000 people a year, that same cost drops to 8 to 9,000 rupees. So scale actually reduces costs.
So how can skilling sector attract private equity investors?
Private equity investors will invest in the skilling sector if the following boundary conditions are met. One, for-profit enterprises can be set up in the skill development center. Okay, right? Okay. Second, if the government funding does not crowd out private sector funding, right? Okay. Third, if there's a full ecosystem. All right, now let me explain all the three things what I said. Now, if through the CSR funds, you can only give for not-for-profits and for trusts and societies, you will not have private equity investing. If all the government programs can only be used by NGOs and not-for-profits and trusts, again, you will not have for-profit entities coming up here. And third, if there is no ecosystem, right, if you cannot make it financially sustainable, if everybody is going to forever make losses in this sector, private equity will not invest. Now, is such a system being created in India? The answer to that question will be, have private equity funds invested in training companies? The answer is, at least in 7 of the NSDC partners, we have seen private equity investments. In 4 of them, we have seen second stage investments, and that the number is increasing. Right? We're not normally tracking it, but this is what we actually, you know. Next, at the end of this year, when you get the balance sheets, we'll actually know what all investment has actually come in. That is happening because they believe that there's space for the private sector. They believe that there is an ecosystem being created, and it is possible to be profitable, and it's not bad to be profitable in this space. In the education sector, you have to be not-for-profit, and therefore you don't see that actually happening. Yet there are equity investments in K-12, in preschools, etc. There have been equities in investments in skilling space.
So any particular regulation that needs to be molded better?
Well, the easiest thing to do is, if you allow CSR money to go to any entity, not only not-for-profits and NGOs.
So, even like for NSDC, 150 million is a very ambitious number. To an observer, it sounds very ambitious. So, how do you think, like, you know, you are moving towards reaching the target? You have just skilled 30 lakh people.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, when you win one gold medal in boxing, world championship, was a dream. To win it 4 times in one's career was actually thought impossible. But you have a, you know, Mary Kom who's done it, right? So I think the target is, you know, I don't like the word. I mean, I think the word ambitious is not the correct word. What we're trying to do is, if you have to actually enable India to reach its, you know, become a developed nation and reach its place in the world, skilling 500 million people is what we need to do, because we would only have 200 million graduates. What would be the other qualification that the other people will have? Either you say we have 700 million graduates by that time, which will be a lopsided economy. So therefore, it's not an ambition, it is a necessity. So I don't think it is unattainable. Yes, it is ambitious. Yes, it is challenging. But I think with creating a real public-private partnership and working on an execution mode in a stable environment will enable that to happen.
What is the immediate next plan of action of NSDC?
We have a certain amount of KRAs for this year. So a number of sector skill councils we have to form, but that is now dependent on whether it means the NSDC board has cleared or whether NSQC has cleared. The second is that between 1st of April 2014 and 31st of March, we need to approve 87 new proposals that have a skill training capacity of X, you know, going ahead. Third is that in this financial year, we should have trained 33 lakh people, right? Then we have separate targets for Udaan, separate, you know, KRAs for STAR, right? And then we have to finish the World Skills selection process. So, you know, we are looking at executing and meeting the targets committed to the National Skill Development Fund in our budget 14-15. At the same time, we have to prepare for next year. Next year, you know, we might double our target, right? So we have to ensure that the number of proposals that we approve this year will meet our next year's target. The sector skill councils become operational. 80% of the entry level jobs, the sector skill councils that we have created, the qualification pack should be up and there. We should have revised our skill gap studies, and every year for the next 3 years bring out an annual kind of a sectoral report on the skill efforts in that sector.
Sure, thank you for sharing all these inputs with us, sir.
You're welcome. Thank you.